Welcome to Question Bank. In this video, I am going to discuss the detailed solution of the questions that were asked in NLC GET exam, which was conducted in 17th for electrical engineering. And let's have the first question. Actually, NLC has also released the answer keys for all the questions, but in this video I am going to discuss the detailed solution and we'll find out all the questions which may have the wrong answer keys by NLC. So first question, the incipient fault in a transformer are identified by, this is correct, that is gas actuated relay. So what are incipient faults? Incipient faults are the internal faults of transformer, such as interlamination short circuit, lowering of oil level, blockage of oil flow path, and all these faults cause overheating of the transformer. And for this, gas actuated relay is used. What is the gas actuated relay? This is the Buchholz relay. Buchholz relay. And where it is placed? It is placed between main tank and the conservator. So generally it is used above 500 kVA transformers. So these are the more informations regarding this. So next question, in a 400 by 230 volt single phase 50 hertz transformer, the primary winding is connected to 400 volt, then emf per turn in primary winding by emf per turn in secondary winding is equal to. So in transformer, emf per turn in primary and secondary is always constant. So this is correct, that is 1:1. Sorry, the is equal to 1. That means if we explain the EMF equation, E1 will be primary voltage 4.44 phi max f n. This is the EMF equation for primary. Similarly, for the secondary, this will be 4.44 phi max f n2. So look at these statements. Here we can find out EMF E1 by N1, that is EMF per turn, which will be equal to 4.44 phi max F. And here also E2 by N2 will be same, that is 4.44 phi max F. So EMF per turn will be same for both primary and secondary. Next question, if UT is equal to 1 for T is greater than 0 and 0 for T is smaller than 0, the value of function, this is the function given and it is asking for the value. So what is UT? UT is the unit step function. This is the definition of unit step function. So here we will see what is the function. Now look at this. I am doing, this one is the function, 5 ut minus 4 u of minus t plus 0.8 u of 1 minus t, and asking the value at t is equal to 0.8. so what is ut? We know that ut is represented like this. Ut is this. This is 1 and this is T, this is UT. So what will be 5UT? 5UT will be, this will be 5. So this is 5UT. This is 5UT. Next is minus 4 U of minus T. Minus 4 U of minus T. We will see what is this one. So first thing, what is U of minus T? U of minus T is this one. Only the line is shifted, or the mirror image of U of T is U of minus T. Then this is U of minus T. Then what is 4 U of minus T? So this will be 4. This will be 4. So this is 4 U of minus T. 4 U of minus T. Now what will be the minus 4 of minus T? This will be shifted to negative values in y axis. So this will be minus 4 into U of minus T. So next is 0.8 U of 1 minus T. 0.8 U of 1 minus T. So how you can draw this one? First thing is U of 1 minus T. 1 minus T. You can realize this one by putting the T values. You can use directly the shifting formula and all these mirror image formula or the tricks, but you can realize this one by using the real values. Put for T is equal to minus 2. What will happen? For T is equal to minus 2, U will be 1 plus 3. This will be, sorry, U 1 plus 2. This is U plus 3. U plus 3 means, definition says this is 1. For T is equal to minus 1, what will happen? U 1 plus 1. This is U plus U of 2 plus 2. So definition says this is also 1. So T is equal to 0. What will happen? U of 1 minus 0. That means U of 1. U of 1 is also 1. Then T is equal to 1 plus 1. So this will be U of 1 minus 1. This will be U of 0. U of 0 is 1 also. 1 or undefined. T is equal to plus 2. What will happen? U of 1 minus 2. This is U of minus 1. That means 0. So what is happening here? Here you can say that. This is U of. This is U of. This is U of 1 minus T. 1 minus T at U of 1 minus T. At positive 1, this is getting 0. U of 1 minus T. So this is U of 1 minus T, and here it is given the value. The value is given to be U of 1 minus T into 0.8. So this value will be 0.8. So this value will be 0.8. So now we will add all the three plots. What are the plots here given? Here one, another one, this one. So what will happen here now? In the negative part, I am adding all these. In the negative part, first thing here, there is nothing in the negative part. Here, this is minus 4. Here, this is minus 4, and here, this is 0.8. So, this will be from infinite, minus infinite to 0. This will be minus 4 plus 0.8. This part will be added. So this will be minus 3.2. And again, at this part, positive part, there is 5. Here there is nothing. And here there is 0.8 up to 1. So I will point out the 1. And here this is plus 5. And here is also plus 0.8. So this will be 5.8 up to this one. And after that, here this is 0 and here this is 5 continuing. So this will be 5 continuing. So this one is minus 3.2. This label is 5 and this label is 5.8. You have to do this very quickly. I am making its description, so I am taking long time. So question here is, at t is equal to 0.8, what will be the value? So at t is equal to 0.8, this is 1. So at 0.8, what will be the value? Value will be 5.8. So answer is 5.8. Here we can select 5.8. So given answer is correct. Next question is given, question number 4. The reactance of a generator is given as 0.3 per unit based on its nameplate, 20 kV and 4 MVA. Find the new per unit reactance using new basis of 25 kV and 200 MVA. This is the question, and this is nothing but the base change formula you can apply. Here new base are given in KVA and in KV and MVA. So what is the formula? Formula Z per unit new value is equal to Z per unit old value into, this is the formula, KV old by KV new, that is voltage base voltage square into MVA new by MVA old. So this is the formula. So what will happen? This will be 0.3 into 20 is the old, 25 is the new, square into new is here the 200 and here 400. So this will be 0.3 into, this will be 4 by 5 square, this will be 16 by 25, and this will be half. So this is coming to be 0.096 per unit. So answer is 0.096 per unit. Here also the given answer is correct. So next question number 5 is, the transfer function of the circuit given below. So here this is RC circuit simple and voltage is across the R, output voltage. So here V input can be given as IS is the current in Laplace form, and here 1 by CS. In Laplace form, this will be 1 by CS plus IS into R. So if I am take IS common, this will be 1 by CS plus R. So IS into 1 plus R CS by CS. This is the V input. What will be the output? V output is only V output will be IS into R. So V output by V input in Laplace form is the transfer function. So this will be IS will be cancelled out. This will be R by 1 plus R CS by CS. So this will be RCS by 1 plus RCS. So answer is this one, SRC by 1 plus SRC. Correct answer. So please watch up to the end of the video so that you can find out which of the questions are given wrong answer by NLC. Question number 6, the number of iterations required to reach convenience in Gauss-Seidel method, the convergence in Gauss-Seidel method of load flow analysis are. This is given actual correct answer, depends upon size of system and increases with the increase of size of system. Number of iteration increases with the increase of size of system. Question number 7. In method of defuzzification, MEOM stands for, mean of maxima. You can, if you have not studied that defuzzification or fuzzy logic, please search the defuzzification methods in Wikipedia and you will find a lot of methods are there, and some methods are related to the maxima, mean of maxima, midpoint of maxima and such methods. So this is mean of maxima. This is also correct answer. Next question, question number 8. The magnetic energy stored for unit volumes is equal to PBh joule per meter cube. Here P is. That means BH. What is P into BH? So this is, actual formula is half BH joule per meter cube. So P value is 0.5. This is correct. So magnetic energy stored for unit volume is given by actually half B square by mu and half B into, I can write this B by mu. B by mu is equal to half into B into H. So this is, or this also can be expressed as in terms of H, mu H square. So this is the answer. Answer is given correct. So question number 9, the inverse Laplace transform of XS is equal to 2 by S into S plus 1 into S plus 2 is. This one is the function and we have to find out its inverse Laplace transform. So here this function I am solving here, 2 by S into S plus 1 into S plus 2 can be written like 1 by S. This is by fraction, 2 by S plus 1 plus 1 by S plus 2. This is, and its inverse Laplace transform, Laplace inverse of the function, suppose this one is xs, will be equal to 1 by s Laplace inverse is u of t, and this is 2 into e to the power minus t ut. This is for 2 by 1 plus s, and for this one this is e to the power minus 2t, e to the power minus 2t ut. So if I take common ut, what will happen? This will be 1 minus 2 e to the power minus t plus e to the power minus t whole square. This is because this is equal to this one, whole multiplied by u of t, and this can be written as this is a square minus 2ab plus b square. So this is a minus b whole square formula. So I can write it as 1 minus e to the power minus t whole square. Here b is e to the power minus t whole into u of t. This is the answer. So here in the option A is given, and this is the correct answer. Next question, question number 10. A 400 volt DC series motor develops shaft torque of 200 newton meter at 80% efficiency while running at 1200 rpm. The current drawn by the motor in amperes is, sorry for this quality less, that is low quality figure, because I have got this question, so I have to read that one. If you are comfortable with this one, please read the question. And I am solving this one, question number 10. Here given 400 volt DC series motor develops shaft torque. Shaft torque is given 200 nanometer at 80% efficiency while running at 1200 rpm. So these are the data given, and here the torque can be represented as mechanical power output by omega r, that is angular frequency. So what will be the power? Power will be torque into omega, root omega r, that is here torque is given to be 200 newton meter into that is omega r is 40 pi radian per second. How I am getting 40 r? This is one revolution is 2 pi radian. So 1200 revolution will be 2 pi into 24 pi. Sorry, 1200 into 2 pi, this will be 2400 pi. So in 1 minute, this is rotating the angle of 2400 pi. For 1 second, this will be 2400 pi by 60. So this will be 40 pi. So this is the omega. So now here this will be 8000 pi watt. This is the power output. As this is the power output and efficiency is given to be 80%. Now I am clearing this one. Efficiency is given to be 80%. So what will be the input power? input power input will be power input will be power output by efficiency. So this will be 8000 pi is the power output by 80% efficiency, that means 0.8. so this is coming to be 10000 pi watt. This is the input power. So current drawn is power by rated voltage. So what is the power? Power is 10000 pi by rated voltage is given to be 400 volt. This is coming to be 25 pi ampere. So here answer is 25 pi. So here is the answer, option 4. Next question, question number 11. In SCR with 4 layers represented as shown in the figure, the figure is somewhat this is not having the contrast. Which are the layers that are equally doped? Which of the layers are equally doped? Here asking. So in this P1 and P2, these two layer are equally doped, whereas this N1 is lightly doped and this N2 is heavily doped. This should be remembered. So here answer is this one as given. Next question, question number 12. Question number 12 is given. Dash is present between air preheater and induced fan in a thermal power plant. This is answer is electrostatic precipitator. This is correct answer. Electrostatic precipitator. What is it doing that in that position? To filter out heavy particles from the smoke of the plant. This is used to filter out heavy particles from the smoke of the plant. So next question is, an op amp has common mode gain of 0.01 and a differential gain of 10 to the power 5. Its common mode rejection ratio would be. So here common mode gain, suppose I am writing AC is 0.01, that means 10 to the power minus 2, and a differential gain I am writing AD to be 10 to the power 5. So common mode rejection ratio, CMRR is given as mod of AD by AC, that means differential gain by common mode gain. So this will be 10 to the power 5 by 10 to the power minus 2, that will be 10 to the power 7. So here answer is 10 to the power 7, but NLC has given 10 to the power minus 7. So this is not correct. Correct answer is 10 to the power 7. Please verify any book that this formula is correct. So now next question, this is one wrong answer given. This is one I am pointing out. Next I will also point out the further if there is any wrong answer. So next question, in an induction motor, the ratio of power developed by the motor to the air gap power is 0.96. the percentage slip is how much? So this is power developed by the motor. This is generally given as gross mechanical power developed, PGMD, and air gap power PAG is generally the rotor input or the starter output. So this is P rotor input. So we know that PGMD, that is gross mechanical power developed, by P air gap power is equal to 1 minus S by 1. This is because here the rest amount is S, and this S is the loss. S is the slip and this represents the rotor loss. So now this is equal to 0.96 as given. So 1 minus S is equal to 0.96 and S will be 0.04. That means 4% slip is 4%. Next question. Armature of a 3-phase alternator has 240 slots. Armature has 8 poles. Its distribution factor is. Its distribution factor. What is the distribution factor formula? Kd. Kd distribution factor. Kd is given as sine m gamma by 2 by m sine gamma by 2. Where m is the slot per pole per phase. So here m will be slots per pole per phase. So this will be 240 total number of slots by 8 poles per phase, 3 phase. So this will be 10. M is 10. And what is gamma? Gamma will be 180 by 3 into, this is the slot angle. So this will be 180 is the angle between two consecutive poles by 3, that is the 3 phase into 10. 10 is the slots per pole per phase. So this will be 10. So this will be 60. So now KD will be sine this will be sorry this is not 60 this is 6 because here 10 and 80 180 0 will be cancelled out and this will be 6 degree. So now this is sine 10 into 6 by 2 by 10 sine m is 10 6 by 2. So this will be sine 30 degree by 10 sine 3 degree. So here is the answer, sine 30 degree by 10 sine 3 degree. Next question number 16. The size of Bose admittance matrix for the single line diagram shown in the figure is. This is the single line diagram given, and here this one is generator 1, generator 2, generator 3 and generator 4. So here 4 buses are present with connected with their respective generators, and it is asking for the size of Bose admittance matrix. So what will be the Bose admittance matrix size? Actually this will be 4 cross 4, this will be 4 cross 4, not 5 cross 5. So here answer is also given wrong. Point out this one, please mark this one. This answer is also wrong because as there are 4 nodes, we can write that Bose admittance matrix like, suppose I am writing the equations in terms of matrix I1, I2, I3, I4 will be equal to Y11, Y12, Y13, Y14, Y21, similarly Y41, Y44. Y44, and this will be multiplied with V1, V2, V3 and V4. As here 4 voltages are given at 4 buses, so how can we represent that to be a 5 cross 5 matrix? Here only 4 voltages are given. 4 voltages are given, so how can we represent that one? So here the Bose admittance matrix is this one. This one is the Bose admittance matrix and this is 4 cross 4 matrix. And here I want to give more data. Here Y11 is Y10, that is a self inductance or self reactance, 12 plus Y13. Similarly, Y22 will be the self inductance and all these values, and Y12 will be Y21 minus of this will be capital Y12. And similarly for Y31 and 13, this will be equal and this will be equal. That is why this is called sparse matrix. So the answer is 4 cross 4, not 5 cross 5. Next question, the transfer function of the system with input RT is equal to 1 plus e to the power minus 3t and response CT is equal to e to the power minus 2t is. This is the question, and here RS will be 1 by S plus 1 by S plus 3. This is the RS. And what is the CS? CS is 1 by S plus 2. So what is the transfer function? Transfer function is CS by RS. CS by RS. And this will be 1 by S plus 2 by 1 by S plus 1 by S plus 3. And if we simplify this one, this will be S into S plus 3 by S plus 2 into 2S plus 3. Because here this will be here and this will be S plus 3 plus S. This will be 2S plus 3. So here answer given is correct. So next question is given. What or how is the relation between charging reactance and length of transmission line? So first thing I want to inform you that what is charging current? The current caused by alternate charging and discharging of line due to alternating voltage is called the charging current. When the transmission line is newly started or newly installed or off for some time, turned off for some time, and we are giving power to this one. So the current which will cause the alternate charging and discharging of the line due to that alternating voltage is called the charging current. So this is why we called the line is charging. So charging current flows even when no load is connected. So charging current flows even when no load is connected. This is due to the capacitance of transmission line with respect to ground. And IC, that is charging current, is given as J omega C into V, that is V by 1 by J omega C. This is XC, capacitive reactance. From this one is coming. And this is the capacitive reactance. And here XC is inversely proportional to capacitance. And capacitance is directly proportional to length of transmission line. So XC, that is charging reactance will be inversely proportional to length of transmission line. So here answer is inversely proportional relation between charging reactance and length of transmission line is inversely proportional. Question number 19. A capacitor C connected to a single phase 50 hertz 240 volt AC supply draws a current of 24 ampere. What would be the current if the voltage applied is charged to 200 volt at 60 hertz? So this is the problem, and here is the capacitor. Here is the source this one is 50 hertz to 40 volt, and this is 24 ampere. So let the capacitance will be C. Let this one is C because this is not given. So capacitive reactance will be, capacitive reactance will be 1 by omega C, 1 by omega C, and ZC, that is impedance, in terms of impedance this will be 0 minus J into 1 by omega C. Omega, what is omega? Omega is 2 pi F. 2 pi F is 50, 2 into 50 is 100, 100 pi. So this will be 100 pi into C. So now this is, I can write it as 1 by 100 pi C angle minus 90 in terms of polar form. So this will be, current will be, current will be V by ZC. This will be 240 angle 0 by 1 by 100 pi C into minus 90. So this will be, this will be 24 angle 90. So this is given, 24 ampere is flowing here. Here given that 24 ampere is given. So 24, this is capacitive reactance, this is I am writing 24 angle 90. So we will forget about the angle. So now we will solve this equation. What will be the next thing? C will be equal to, now this is, I can write it as 240 into 100 pi C is equal to 24. So C will be 24 by 100 pi into 240. This will be 1 by 1000 pi. So when V will be, we are getting the capacitance value. So when V is equal to 200 volt and frequency is 60 hertz, this will be ZC will be 1 by 2 pi into 60 into that C value is 1000 pi. So this is coming to V and angle minus 90, and this is coming to V 25 by 3 minus 90. And what will be the current? Current will be 200 angle 0 by 25 by 3 minus 90, and this will be 24 angle 90. Those current will be same current will flow. So answer will be 24 ampere. So next question, question number 20, let Vs be the sending end voltage, then receiving end voltage under no load condition for short and long transmission line respectively. For short transmission line, generally capacitance is not considered, so Vs will be Vr, that is receiving end voltage will be sending end voltage. But in case of long transmission line, capacitance is considered and Ferenc effect comes into the picture. So due to Ferenc effect, Vr, that is the receiving end voltage, will be greater than that of sending end voltage. So answer is option number 4. Here in the next question, if the output of the circuit is a triangular wave, the input of the circuit must be. So here in this figure, this is given that this is an op-amp and here there is a capacitance. So what will happen if we come from the beginning, here I is equal to Vi minus R. What is I? I is the current flowing here. Here is, this is the current flowing, Vi minus R, and here, and the same current will flow through this one, because into the op-amp there will be no current, because of this is the ideality. Because of the ideality, there will be no current which is flowing into the op amp. So I will be V prime. Suppose I am giving this one V prime. V prime minus V output by 1 by Cs. So this will be simply V output will V prime is equal to 0, because the virtual ground concept, this is 0, so this will be also 0. So this is I will be minus Cs V0, and as here given, this one will be equal to this one. So VIYR is equal to minus Cs V0. So V0 will be equal to 1 by Cs minus 1 by Cs minus 1 by Cs VIYR. So in terms of here, there is a S in the denominator. So I can write it in terms of time domain, like minus 1 by RC. As this is a, there is a S in the denominator, this can be represented like V output T dt plus VC 0 plus. So this is an integrator circuit. If you don't know anything about op-amp, if you know this is an integrator circuit, you can directly solve this problem. No need to do all these things. If you don't know this is an integrator circuit, you have to do this one and you have to find out which type of circuit this is. So then you know that this is an integrator circuit. So as output is triangular wave, output, as output is triangular wave, so input will be square wave. So input will be square wave. When square wave is operated through the integrator circuit, the output will be triangular. Similarly, if the input is step, then the output will be ramp, and for impulse input, the output will be step input. So here answer is square wave. Next question: which of the following statement is wrong with reference to parallel operation of alternators as compared to single large unit? So here this one is given easy maintenance, this is correct. And here option number 3, reduced operating cost, this is also correct. And better reliability, this is also correct. Poor efficiency, this is not correct. So answer given is true, because this is given statement is wrong. So this is not poor efficiency, actually efficiency increases. Question number 23, an over compounded DC generator is supplying a load at 220 volt. If the machine terminal voltage is 220.2, then the load current is 10 ampere. What will be the machine terminal voltage when the load is 600 ampere? This is the problem. So here first thing is over compounded DC generator. So in case of over compounded DC generator, in compound generator, if the terminal voltage is increasing, after if we increase the load, then this is the cumulatively compound generator. Series field, in which series field overcompensate the change in the shunt field. So I can draw the plot. Suppose this one is the load current. This is the terminal voltage, and this is the label no load voltage, VNL. I am writing VNL, no load voltage. So for over compounded DC generator, plot is like this. This is over. And for flat compounding, this will be like this. And where this is intersecting, this current is I rated current. And for under compounded, this is generator, under compounded, this will be like this. This is under, and this one is flat compounded. So now here, this is given that 220 volt. If you don't know anything, you can directly solve 220.2 minus 220 volt will be equal to 0.2 volt. This is the voltage drop, and this voltage drop is getting across the resistance. We can find out by 0.2 by current. Current is 10 ampere given. So this will be equal to 0.02 ohm. So when load current is 600 ampere, so what will be the drop? Drop will be 0.02 ohm into 600 ampere. So this will be 12 volt drop. So what will be the terminal voltage? Terminal voltage is the, sorry, what will be the machine terminal voltage? This will be 220 volt plus 12 volt is drop. So this will be 232 volt. So here is the answer. Next question, question number 24. In polyphase AC circuit, the phase sequence RYB is same as, we have to find out only the order, nothing else. So after R, we are getting Y, and then we are getting B. We have to find out only this thing. So here after R, we are getting here, after R, we are getting Y, and after Y, here the answer is given to be Y, B and R. After R, we are getting Y, this is correct, and after Y, we are getting B, this is also correct, and after B, this here the same order. So as order is same, the phase sequence is same. So next question, Z transform of unit step function is given by, what is the Z transform of unit step function? This is 1 by Z, 1 minus Z inverse. So this will be Z by Z minus 1, option number 4. Question number 26, question number 26 is given, what is the balanced condition for the given bridge? So this is very easy, Z1 into R3 will be equal to Z4 into R2. So here answer is given. Next question, the law in mechanical system which is analogous to Kirchhoff's law in electrical system. This is D'Alembert's principle. Next question is 28. Which of the following are the variable losses in induction motor? So in case of induction motor, the loss can be classified into fixed loss and variable loss. What are the fixed losses? Fixed losses are starter and rotor core loss, then bearing and frictional loss, and last one is the brush friction or windage loss. These are fixed losses. And what are the variable losses? That is starter ohmic loss, rotor ohmic loss, or the copper loss, then brush contact electrical loss, and stray loss. So here in every option there is core loss. So core loss means this is constant loss. So variable loss will be only the stray load loss. So this is the answer. Next question is, the air gap flux of an alternator has a third harmonic component along with the fundamental component. If the coils are short pitched by an angle of alpha for fundamental wave, then the pitch factor of the corresponding to the third harmonic wave is, for For third harmonic wave, what will be the pitch factor? So, to eliminate nth harmonic, the pitch factor should be like this. Cos n alpha by 2, nth harmonic. If we have to eliminate nth harmonic, then this is the formula for pitch factor. So, to eliminate third harmonic, we have to do this. Cos 3 alpha by 2, cos 3 alpha by 2. So next question number 30, damper bar, rotor bar, commutator, and here in list B something are given. So this is very easy. First we have to point out commutator to DC machine, then rotor bars will be induction machine and damper bars will be for synchronous machine. Next question number 31. In the given circuit shown in the figure, SCR is fired at 45 degree. Load voltage and current omega t is equal to phi will be. So here this one is the circuit and this is SCR is fired at 45 degree. So here suppose this one is the voltage and SCR is fired at 45 degree. Suppose this one is 45, this one is pi. So what will, as there is an inductor, the current will be continuous. So here I am changing the color. Voltage will be like this because the current will be continuous. Current is like this. Here is current becoming zero. So the load voltage is zero. Load voltage and current at omega is equal to pi. Omega is equal to pi, that means here pi. This will be zero, means voltage is equal to zero, load current is non-zero only. So answer is only load voltage is zero. Next question, 3 capacitors 10 microfarad, 20 microfarad, 30 microfarad are connected in parallel across 150 volt sinusoidal. Then identify the correct statement. Maximum voltage, answer is given, maximum voltage will be applied across 10 microfarad. This is wrong answer. So point out this one. This is also given wrong. So for parallel connections, the voltage across all the capacitors will be same. Voltage across all the capacitors will be same because in case of series connection, voltage across the capacitors will be different because here same current is flowing in case of same current and capacitances are different. So there will be XC10, that means the capacitive reactance of 10 microfarad will be greater than that of XC of 20, and this will be greater than XC of 30, and that is why Z will also follow the same path and V will also be greater across 10 microfarad will be in case of series, but in case of parallel the options given, all the options are wrong. If the question can be modified to this is not parallel, this is series, then the answer is correct. As this is given as parallel, the answer will be voltage across all the capacitors will be same. Next question, question number 33. For single phase transformer shown above, the magnetizing current drawn is 1 ampere and secondary current is 1 ampere. Then primary current is, neglect core loss and leakage reactance. So magnetizing current is given, secondary current is given 1 ampere. So what will be the primary current? As secondary current is 1 ampere, primary current will be, this is ratio is 1:2. So this will be 1:2. Because current will be step up from secondary to primary. So this will be 2 ampere in primary. So neglecting core loss and leakage reactance, the wattful current which will cause energy consumption, that will be, so I will be equal to, this is the wattful current and I will be I magnetizing, this is not wattful current, this is watt less current, magnetizing current square plus 2 square, 2 is the wattful current and this will be, this is wattful, IW I am writing, this is 1 square plus 2 square root over, because wattful current, suppose this one is phi and this one is E, so wattful, this is IM, this is magnetizing current, this is wattless current and this is wattful current, IW, and its resultant is the actual current flowing, this is I. So next question, here the answer is 3. Next question, question number 34. Zero inductance and infinite resistance are the feature of, this is open coil, clearly open coil, because in short circuit coil there will be 0L 0L 0R 0R, but here given infinite resistance, so this will be, for coil connected to DC voltage source, what will be this one, there will be 0L and 0L and 0R, also same, and for coil connected to AC voltage source, there will be non-zero L and 0 R. So this one is the correct answer. If D is duty ratio, the input and output relation of a buck converter and boost converter are. So here V output for buck converter is D into V in, D into V in, and for boost converter, this is V output is equal to 1 by 1 minus D. How you can find out? This is, you can find out by D value is always between 0 to 1. So in buck converter, output voltage is less than input voltage. So this will be D, whose value is between 0 to 1 into V in. So this will be less. So in case of a boost converter, V output will be greater than V input. So this will be 1 by 1 minus D. So this will be, this term will be greater than 1. So this will be, V output will be greater than V input. Next question is, relate reluctance with the following. So reluctance is the magnetomotive force which is analogous to electromotive force, that is EMF, and by the magnetic flux which is analogous to the current in electrical circuit. So here this will be, the unit of magnetomotive force is ampere turn, so this will be ampere turn per Weber. This is the unit. Next question, a moving coil instrument has a coil resistance of 10 ohms and it can take maximum current of 100 milliampere. What modification is required in the instrument to measure the voltage in the range 0 to 500 volt? So what is the what we can measure first thing, what we can measure? 10 ohm is the coil resistance and it can take up to maximum 100 milliampere. So what we can measure? What we can measure first thing? 10 into 100 milliampere. So this will be 1 volt. We can measure 1 volt with this meter. So what we want to measure? To measure 500 volt. So we have to connect a series resistance so that the maximum voltage drop will be across that resistance and minimum voltage drop will be across the meter, and this will be proportionate to the whole resistance so that we can measure that voltage. So M will be 500 by 1. This is 500. And what is M? M is the multiplier. So this is the resistance, series resistance will be Rm, meter resistance into M minus 1. So this will be 10 is the meter resistance, 500 minus 1. So this will be 4990 ohm. So in kilo ohm, 4.99 kilo ohm in series. So answer is 2. Next question, question number 38. Which of the following type of measuring instrument is used in measurement of both AC and DC quantities? So I am now giving the summary of that instrument. Suppose this one is PMMC, permanent magnet moving coil. This is moving iron type instrument. This is electrodynamic, or this is also called EMMC. So now I am writing to measure, suppose AC, DC, and I will mark what we can measure. V, I, the voltage, current and power. I will mark this one for which instrument what we can measure. So for PMMC we can only measure DC voltage and current only. In case of moving iron type instrument we can measure both AC and DC and both voltage and current, but not power. But in case of electrodynamometer type we can measure both AC, DC, voltage, current and also including that power. So here question is given, which type of measuring instrument is used to measure both AC and DC quantities? So here this will be dynamometer type, because this one is not given. So now in this problem, identify the bridge network shown above. This is given, which type of bridge? This is Wien's bridge, which is used to measure the frequency. Next question is given, question number 40. If a current IC of t is equal to 16 U of t is applied through a capacitor C, the voltage VCT across the capacitor is given as. So voltage across the capacitor is represented by 1 by C integration of I dt. So simply we have to simply integrate this one. So 1 by C integration of ut is t, that is ramp. So this will be answer will be this much, 16 by C t, 16 by C into t. So this is the answer. So this is the end of this video, and I will discuss another 40 questions in the next video. So thank you for watching up to here.